back from the dead. I know usually when I start a video, I like to do some random fact or like something fun related to me or paranormal. But honestly, I'm talking about the Cecile Hotel today, and I feel like there is so much to cover that we just need to jump right into it. Hey guys, what's up? Welcome back to my channel, and obviously this has been a huge, wide requested video, and honestly, I don't know what has taken me so long to do this, which is about the Cecile Hotel, inspired from, you know, the series American Horror Story, and it's in Los Angeles, California. Let's talk about why this place has such an odd, strange past. So obviously the hotel has to have some sort of a haunted background, paranormal background, past, which has made people want to know more about the hotel. But the question is, where do these haunts come from? Why are they there? And what's the history behind it? Actually, there's a lot. There's a lot of history behind it. And even though I'm gonna go over the history with you guys, do keep in mind that this may not even be all of the history. Not all deaths, suicides, murders, who knows, could have been reported. Especially like back in the day, sometimes people kept things under wraps. So take in mind, this may not even be all of the deaths that have taken place at the Cecile Hotel. Okay, so November 19th, 1931, the LA Times, which is a huge, you know, magazine slash more like a newspaper, but depends on if you're online reading it nowadays. But they reported that there was a 46-year-old man that was missing, and he was from Manhattan Beach. So if you're not familiar with LA, Manhattan Beach is a little bit further south of LA. So this man had been missing, but finally it's reported that they had actually found him. So 1931, this guy actually checks into the Cecile Hotel as James Willies of Chicago. Why? It must have been like, you know, back in the day, a cowboy name, who knows, nickname. So he'd been checked into the Cecile for a week, and they just now happened to find his body. He had basically taken a ton of poisonous pills and killed himself. So this incident of 1931 is the very first incident reported at the Cecile Hotel of the first suicide. Now this obviously makes kind of, you know, a big deal throughout LA, especially if it was reported in the LA Times. So then less than a year later, another suicide happens. Guy named Benjamin, he's 25 years old, there's no suicide note left, and he ends up shooting himself in the head, and they end up finding his body. The maid service, I believe, is who found his body. Okay, so let's fast forward a couple years. Now we're into 1934 at the Cecile Hotel. This one gets me. A 53-year-old who's a former Army Medical Corps sergeant, who is named Louis D. Borden. Oddly, it's a Borden, who knows why. He checks into the hotel in 1934, and he basically slashes his throat. He leaves a suicide note explaining that his health was in poor condition and he had no reason or will to continue to live. Why does this break my heart? You guys know I'm like a huge veterans advocate. Anytime I can donate time, I will go help homeless veterans and, you know, anyone that's struggling with the aftermath of PTSD, and homeless vets, I'll give free haircuts too because I still have my cosmetology license. So this one just gets me because I just hate how much the VA has, you know, lacked on helping our veterans. I feel like there should never be a homeless veteran. Never be a veteran needing food, and never a veteran that needs medical attention, and so this one hit close to home for me. So now we fast forward again, we're in 1937. Some woman named Grace decides she has fallen from the ninth story window. Still to this day, it's unsure if she actually committed suicide or if she was pushed. The odd thing about this suicide, or whatever it's called, is that when she was either pushed or jumped from the window, they had the old school like telephones that are still attached to the wall, and her entire body was entangled in the phone wire. And so it kind of grasped her fall a little bit, but she did still hit the ground, and she still actually ended up dying later at the hospital. But it's like, what a weird freaking death to be entangled by a telephone wire, but then still die. It's just odd. Okay, so we got another suicide that gets me. So it's just constant suicides, right? So now we have 1938, we're fast forwarding again, a guy named Roy Thompson. He's a 35-year-old Marine. He had been staying at the Cecil Hotel for several weeks because you can actually rent at the hotel still to this day as like an apartment rather than just like per night. So this Marine went to the very top floor. Somehow he got through all of the locked exits and accesses up to the roof and jumped to his death onto the sidewalk and died. I don't like veteran suicides. It just gets me. It's one of those things that just gets me. Another one. May of 1939, we have a sailor now, so it's a veteran from the Navy. His name's Irwin. He's 39 years old. He died in his room after committing suicide by taking poison. Nearly a year later, another woman that's 45 named Dorothy finds out about the Navy sailor's death and decides that she's gonna go out the same way. So she takes the same poison inside of the Cecil Hotel. And actually, oddly, no one knows if she actually survived or not. They do know and have records of her being rushed to the hospital, but no one knows if she survived or not. Now here's where it starts getting weird. You're starting to get weird ties with connections. So obviously we have a lot of veteran suicides here. So now we're into 1944, another woman named Dorothy, who's 19, decides to go into the Cecil Hotel and she throws her newborn from one of the windows. It's supposedly said that the story goes that she ended up having the baby in the middle of the night. She had no idea that she was pregnant and ended up accidentally giving birth, and she didn't want to wake her boyfriend or fiance, whoever he was, who was asleep in the bed next to her, and tell him, oh my god, I just was pregnant and then I gave birth. So she decides she's going to throw it out of the window. So what happened to her? Well, she was obviously found guilty of homicide for, you know, killing her newborn, but she went through some sort of a lengthy process with the court system, and they did eventually deem her of insanity. She was off the hook. 1947, a 35-year-old resident from Long Beach, which once again is not far from Manhattan Beach, so just a little bit further south of LA, goes to the Cecil Hotel, somehow once again breaks into the very top floor of the hotel, and jumps to his death and commits suicide via jump, big jump. Okay, so this is a very interesting one. Now we're back even more further in the future. Now we're in 1954. There is a woman that has checked into the hotel, and she's been going by the name of Helen Gurnice. Gurney or Gurnice, I'm not sure how it's pronounced. She was staying on the 7th floor and at some point decided she was going to end her life, and she jumped out of the window and committed suicide. What's the horrible part? She ended up landing somehow on top of the Cecil Hotel's marquee. If you ever look at pictures of the Cecil Hotel, there's like a marquee slash, well, there was, I don't know if it's changed, and then the actual title of the Cecil Hotel. She landed right on top of that, so you can imagine the sound that made when she fell from the 7th floor. What is the interesting part? Here it is. A week prior to her death, they looked at the records from this woman that was going by the name of Helen and realized that she had checked in with the name, with her identification, of Margaret Brown. So the question is, and it's still a mystery to this day, Margaret Brown, AKA Molly Brown, the unsinkable Molly Brown of the Titanic. Now, wait a second. This is where we don't want to get stories like super confusing and conflicted. The reason I found this so interesting was, if you don't know the story of Molly Brown, there was, you know, a bunch of people obviously on the Titanic, half made it, half didn't. One that actually survived was Molly Brown, AKA Margaret Brown. And she actually owned two summer homes in Colorado, which are very haunted, might I add. I have been to both of them. One of them is in downtown Denver, which serves a lot of teas, And they don't really like to sell out on the whole haunted paranormal thing. So if you try to contact them, they do their own tours, but they are not interested. Trust me, I have tried for years. They're not interested in being a part of anything else. The other summer home was actually in Lakewood, which was not far from my house. It's like, now they've turned it into a wedding venue, but the owner originally, I actually got to go in there. It's very haunted. Like, you can feel a strong female presence, which is who Molly Brown was supposed to be about. So the connection is, supposedly Molly Brown did die in New York from a brain tumor, but apparently her identification was with this woman named Margaret Brown. So I don't really know. It's weird, right? Like, very odd. How do you connect these? It's just strange. Okay, now we're in 1962. A woman named Julia decides she's gonna climb out of her balcony window. She's 50 years old, and this time it's on the 8th floor. She did not leave a suicide note. She ended up landing in some sort of a light well down below, which is how they heard her crash. But the weird thing was, is that they were assuming maybe she was broke because she was showing just bus tickets, and she was not from the Los Angeles area, which is where the Cecile is. And they ended up finding out later that she actually had about $1,800 in her account. So what was her motive? So this incident is February. Now we're gonna move into October of the same year, 1962. A woman that's 27 years old named Pauline. Okay, this one's kind of sad. Okay, so her and her husband named Dewey are in a fight. They've been bickering and fighting all night. The husband decides, I'm gonna leave. I've had it with the fighting. I'm going to let you calm down and come home. So Pauline, 27, decides when Dewey leaves that she's upset, she's been hurt, she's tired of the relationship. This is again on the 9th floor. So think about this, 7th, 8th, and 9th floor seem to have connection somehow. So she decides while he's at dinner that she's gonna commit suicide. She's gonna get out onto her window and she's gonna jump out. And the sad part is that when that happened, she landed on a guy named George, who's 65 years old, who is minding his own business, walking on the sidewalk below. She landed on him, squished him, killed him instantly, and they both died. Okay, so 1964, it's just death after death. This retired telemarketer named Pigeon Goldie is found dead in her room. She'd been ransacked and she'd been murdered. She was stabbed, strangled, raped, left for dead, basically. So here's the weird part. There was a guy that had later been arrested in connection to her death. He'd been seen walking in a local park covered in blood that also matched hers. And for some reason, they let him go. The police let him go. And no one else was ever charged with her murder. What? Like, what's the deal, you know? Okay, so now we get a break from the deaths, except now we have to fast forward to the dreaded day of February 19th, 2013, just a few years ago, right? A naked body of a woman who was 21 years old, who's from Canada, was found naked floating inside of the water supply tank on top of the hotel. Her name was Elisa Lamb. If I said her name wrong, I'm sorry, it's an apology. I'm not good with names. So Elisa had been missing for like a minute. She'd been gone for a while. In fact, I believe it was 3 weeks she'd been missing. Her family had reported her, her friends had reported her. There was like no trace of her. So it's horrifying what happened. So basically what ended up happening was she's missing, no one knows where she's at. I do believe her belongings were there. They were under the assumption maybe she just like walked away from her stuff, they didn't know. So 3 weeks into her missing, the people that live there, I told you guys, there's still people that live inside the Cecile Hotel today, to this day, like they've been residents there. They start complaining that the water that they're drinking and the water they're bathing in and brushing their teeth in tastes gross for some reason. What's wrong with the water, guys? Like, we gotta call management. Like, maybe the filtration system isn't working. Ugh. So seriously, I'm not kidding you. A maintenance worker went up to the ceiling or the roof, which is where this water tank is located. And of course he wasn't expecting to open it and see a woman inside. There's so many weird pieces to this though. There's a hole on the top of the water tank, and I think that they might use rainwater when it falls in, if that makes sense. And then they can like what do? Like, distill the rainwater or filter it or whatever. And I guess this girl somehow crawled inside of this tiny hole. Like, I mean, it was a tiny hole. There is no other entrance other than having a key to get in. When the maintenance worker was up there, he said there was no signs of, like, foul play. Like, nobody had broken into the water tower. No one had make, like, a makeshift, you know, handle to get in. There was no way to get inside of it other than this little hole. And they said it just blew their mind. Like, how is she naked and why is she inside of there and how did she get inside of it? They said that when they actually removed her body, the coroner's office tried to squeeze parts of her body through this hole with dimensions just to see, like, obviously she crawled in, that had to have been it. And it was not the case, guys. They could not figure out how she got in. It was, like, almost inhumanly possible unless she, like, removed bones temporarily to get inside of this. Like, and why would you crawl inside of a water tank, you know? Like, even if you crawled in, how are you gonna get back out? And it was just very strange. Keys to the water tank, and they both had alibis, which were the maintenance workers. And I don't think that they were on staff that night. They have been completely cleared of the murder, completely. Why did the water taste bad? Of course, her body was decomposing. They think she had been in there for a few weeks at least. It was ruled as an accidental drowning. It was found that she did actually drown, but still to this day, no one knows how she got inside of the freaking tank. Now, this is where the story turns very odd, and this is where your paranormal enthusiast is gonna come out and be like, what is going on? So they decide, you know, even though it's been 3 weeks, they have video footage all over the hotel because they have residents that actually live there. So it's for the protection of the residents. So they find this video footage of Elisa, like, running around the hotel, hiding inside of an elevator, peeking around the corner. She looks completely paranoid, but nothing's there. She's pushing the elevator buttons. She looks like she's like astray in a panic. She's hiding around the corner. She's waving her arms, but they're showing that no one's there. There is nothing there. There's no one walking by. There's no entity that you can visually see, but obviously something is chasing her. So this brought so much attention to the public after it happened because people were like, I mean, it looks so paranormal related. There's nothing there. Literally, it's invisible air. And I've heard a lot of people tell me that this video in particular is what made them believe in the afterlife or paranormal, or, you know, that probably dark stuff exists. Obviously, if she wound up dead, this had to have been something related to her that was dark. There's been accusations that she was accused of being bipolar, having mental disabilities, and then that led into people being possessed. I've told you guys, when I've like experienced discussions with people and I've witnessed what I believe is possession a couple of times, I truly believe that there's two ways you can get possessed. It's either one, you're not mentally strong enough to handle it, so if she did have some sort of a mental illness, that could contribute to it. Or two, I think there's people out there that want to experience possession. I know that sounds crazy, but I'm serious. I've seen that happen once before. I still don't agree with anyone saying, even if she is bipolar or has some sort of mental disability, what's the explanation for ending up in the water tower? And naked. And by the way, they never found her clothes that she was wearing before the water tower. So were they thrown over the edge? I mean, there was no sign of it. Another reason that they never checked the roof either, this is really weird too, guys. They never went to even check the roof for those 3 weeks, or the water tower for that matter, is because they had put like triple, quadruple security locks on each section on their way to the roof. The new security staff had. The reason they did that is there's been so many suicides where people will walk to the roof and jump off. So they were trying to prevent it. So there's actual like alarms that go off to security when you enter each of these different sections until you get to the roof. And however she got up there, which still nobody knows, none of the alarms went off, and that's why the roof was never checked for 3 weeks. And they had some sort of a notification system to let security know if security had been breached to the roof, so that they could go check and make sure a suicidal person's not up there, or go check the sidewalks around the hotel. And security had not been breached according to the system they had in place. We're talking 2013, guys. Like, we're not talking back in 1921. 2013, yeah, sure, it was four or five years ago, but security can't be that bad a few years ago, you know what I'm saying? June 2015, here we go again, Los Angeles Times reports the body of a 28-year-old male. He's been found outside of the hotel this time. They believe that he's committed suicide at some point from the top of the hotel. But the weird thing was, once again, is the coroner's office released that his reason for death, cause of death, had not been released and it was not determined. I don't know, what does that mean? Like, if someone jumps off a building at full force, however many stories it is, you're gonna either become extremely injured and it's gonna be visible, or you're gonna die and it's gonna be visible. So how the coroner's office could report that it's undetermined, I don't understand, I don't get it. So a guy named William Bakes Hanner is the one that founded, constructed, named the Cecil Hotel in 1924, is when it was actually built. He only built it for like a destination for business and travelers and tourists. So it wasn't supposed to be like, you know, it's become kind of a big name now. The cost of it, even for 1924, was $1 million. That's a lot of money for 1924. The marble lobby is what it's known for. It's still there today, which is where you kind of got the theme for American Horror Story. There is stained glass windows, once again, American Horror Story. They have a lot of alabaster statues throughout the entire thing. And I think even the handrails that go upstairs. So what's the sad part about this is it's built in 1924. A few years later, the United States goes into the Great Depression. And I mean, you know, he's hurt. He's obviously, you know, financially hurt from building this. And because of the Great Depression, that is when Skid Row becomes what Skid Row is. There is no exact estimate on how many people live on Skid Row. I have a ton of people that are in Europe. Holler to all my Europe fans. But if you don't know what Skid Row is, it's basically the biggest area of homelessness in the United States. They estimate somewhere around 10,000 to 20,000 people, give or take. I think that winter times, it probably boosts more just because it is a warmer environment in LA. It's about 4 miles of homelessness, basically. And it can be quite dangerous, sadly, because people rob each other. People rob, you know, normal people that walk by because they're that desperate. You know, they've kind of lost a lot of faith in humanity because they've been on the street, poor, broke. So they kind of do whatever it takes to survive. So Skid Row is not a safe place for anybody to be, even the homelessness. So by the 1950s, we're looking at this hotel, which is the Cecile Hotel, which is not far from Skid Row. And now it's been known for just having, transit people in and out constantly because, and it was actually cheap to stay there, one of the cheaper hotels. And so if people got desperate in Skid Row and got a little bit of money, they would run over to, you know, stay in the Cecile Hotel just because they needed to shower up or wash up or whatever. The odd thing also about the Cecile Hotel is when it was constructed, it's not a typical hotel. So it has like, you know, 4 rooms, which are small. I think they're around like 500 square feet or less. And then there's community, like, or communal bathrooms or showers. So you can go, you know, it's not like open showers, but you have like little rooms as showers and it's all together in one area. So if you will, it's kind of like a hostel or maybe even a little different from a hostel. Now, American viewers that are watching, not all hostels kill people. So don't go into that realm of the death movie Hollywood side. So yeah, the Cecile was built a little bit different than what you think of as a typical hotel. It does have some rooms that do have, you know, private bathrooms and sinks and little kitchenettes. And those are the rooms that they will rent out to this day as, you know, residences, or, you know, they'll sign a week lease with people or a month lease, or there's people that have been living there for quite a while, is my understanding. So new ownership did take over in 2007 and then again, I believe, in 2013. So finally, February 28th of 2017, just this year, the Cecile Hotel was granted historic status by the city of Los Angeles, which means it can never be torn down. It will be there permanently. The Cecile Hotel has some really strange connections with other things. If you guys remember the Black Dahlia or Elizabeth Short, she's the victim of the Black Dahlia who was actually cut in half. She actually made a last stop at the Cecile Hotel before her death in 1947. I mean, it's disputed how long she was there. It's disputed by a lot of things, who the Black Dahlia actually was and what she was doing with her life choices. But she was seen at the Cecile Hotel. It was actually granted that, yeah, they had seen her there previously and they knew her. The people that worked there knew her as someone that would frequently come in. They didn't know if it was she was meeting maybe clients for something, friends for something, or if she actually stayed at that hotel herself. The Cecile is also, you know, been known for having serial killers stay there. Of course it is. What else does it not have? So Richard Ramirez, which is a serial killer from 1985, and a guy named Jack from 1991. Richard Ramirez is known as the Night Stalker. He was an American serial killer and rapist. And he would do burglarizing basically at the same time from 1984 to 1985. They believe he may have been practicing Satanism. He was actually captured at some point. He got lazy and they admitted or found out that he had 13 victims at least. And so he was living in the top floor of the Cecile when he was arrested. Basically, he was renting it for $14 a night. And this was back, like I said, in the mid 80s. They don't know if he killed officially any of his, women that he raped inside of the Cecile. They think that maybe he kept work separate than home, but he was living there for quite a while. He was sentenced to a gas death chamber in 1989. They say that he showed no remorse for the killings that he did. So now there's another Austrian serial killer that we have named Jack, who also stayed at the Cecil Hotel while he was committing various murders. So in 1991, he stayed at the Cecil Hotel for about 5 weeks. During this time, he started meeting prostitutes and killing them. He would pay prostitutes to come up to his room and sneak them in through the fire escape for about $30 each time. So he was doing the murders in his room. I'm not sure which floor or room he was in. Apparently they found out, local authorities in LA found out that he had been arrested and jailed for the same crimes in Austria, and somehow he had been let free, basically. He ended up somehow getting released from the Los Angeles Police Department. I don't know what is wrong there. And he actually worked for the Los Angeles County Crime Writer Department and helping them out. So I'm assuming that was some sort of a plea deal. We'll cut your years back or your time back if you help us out doing crime writing. I don't know. Another fun fact about the serial killer of Richard Ramirez is that when he would murder his victims, which once again, they do not think that that actually took place inside of the Cecil, but the way he would strangle them, the women, is he would take their bra straps and cut off their circulation. Interesting group of people going on here. So it's a, you know, obvious statement that we can say there is some dark shit going on at the Cecil Hotel. So obviously after, you know, 2013 of Elisa, they got some really bad press, or I guess bad press to them. And they kind of got really hush-hush about the paranormal and about haunted and darkness and murders and crime and all this stuff. I actually did go to the Cecil Hotel last, I want to say it was October, it could have been August of last year. I just wanted to see what it was about. As you guys know, I go to LA very often, and I've actually driven by the Cecil Hotel several times. It has changed names a bunch. As of right now, I do believe the title of it is Stay on Main in LA. It's the same building. I think they have tried to change the name in hopes of, you know, bringing a different type of crowd or people to the hotel. I went in, like I said, last year, and they actually had bodyguards. And if you don't have some sort of a reservation, or if you don't live there as a resident, they don't want you in there. They don't want you snooping around or looking around, which I actually found very odd, because most hotels welcome you in even if you don't stay there, because you want to look around and see how it is. But they will not let you in. I don't know if that's to protect the residents, the long-term residents that they've had staying there. So why are they hiding all of this? Well, I've told you guys, when I have discussed haunted locations with people that own haunted locations, there's two things that happen. Either one, they're very open to it, like the Stanley Hotel, like the Lizzie Borden house. They're like, yes, this is the way my life is. Or they're on this side of the spectrum, which is, I'm ashamed, I'm embarrassed. It could be, you know, I don't want people to think that it's a religious based issue. Like, yes, we have ghosts here, so that's the Antichrist. Like, people get really weird about it, seriously, if their location is haunted. So that's why I tell you guys, if you're going in to investigate, you have to be very delicate with the situation, because you don't want to piss the owner off so you can't go back. That's what I feel like is happening with the Cecil Hotel. In my opinion, I understand that it is within Skid Row. You know, that's really hard because it's a poor area. It's probably not the safest area, even though it's not total in direct proximity to Skid Row. But if they could get somebody in there, into the Cecil Hotel, even to put some money into fixing it up, because I have heard and I've seen reviews on it that it's just not in good shape. If they could boost it up a little bit and actually play to the paranormal side, which we've seen success, right? We've seen the Stanley Hotel is a multi-million dollar business a year, guys. I'm not kidding. Because they have ghost hunters flocking from all over the world to go have an experience. And I mean, I've stayed up there, I told you, so many times when I lived in Colorado. Or you have the Lizzie Borden house, how successful they are. I hate to use Bobby Mackey's as an example, but I will. You know, Wanda tried to let investigators come in for like $700-$800 a night and investigate. So if the people at the Cecil Hotel would embrace the paranormal side, more than anything, it would be successful, but they have to change some stuff. You know, having really teeny rooms isn't going to work. They need to do some construction, make the rooms like a regular hotel so that we as ghost hunters have space to go in, even if we're just renting a room for the night to investigate inside of it. And they need to do haunted tours. You know how much money they could make off of that if they did haunted tours? Obviously, something's going on here. Suicide after suicide with murders and death and serial killers and a lot of strange stuff. Poor Elisa. Let's just be respectful at this moment and say our heart and love go out to her family. Because could you imagine being her family and not really ever understanding what happened to her and why she died and what her final moments are, and they have no explanation as to how she got in the water tank, and they have her on security camera, guys. Like, that's another reason why these two, you know, guys that had the keys to the water tank were cleared. When she's running around on security, she's by herself. There is nobody around, like, at all to help her. So it's not like she was abducted and kidnapped by one of these guys. You know, it was bizarre. It was so bizarre. And it makes you wonder, like, was she seeing something? Is there energy there? And bad, there has to be, obviously. As ghost hunters, we know this. Like, when you do locations and you do history of a location, you have to know what you're walking into once you start doing the history. You know, on one side, you can be like, oh, this sounds like, yep, definitely probably some sort of like Satanism or black magic or some really dark shit's going on here. Or you can go on this side and hear their story and you're like, yeah, this doesn't sound that bad. It sounds like it's probably an Indian burial ground. You know your history, and if you've had enough experiences as an investigator, you know when something sounds dark, it probably is. And this place sounds like there are some serious things going on. I don't know if I feel comfortable enough to go stay at the Cecile Hotel at this point. It's not in a good part of LA, I'm gonna be honest with you guys, because I know LA. I'm assuming that it hasn't been put on a big show like Ghost Hunters or Ghost Adventures because there's residents in there. They're not gonna be able to call their residents that actually live there and rent rooms every month or year and be like, sorry, you have to leave for the night. Like, you just can't do that. That's something else that they need to change too. It either needs to stay as a hotel or not. Period. And there's no in-betweens, you know? So I think that whoever is managing it isn't doing it right. There could be some serious potential in this for, you know, the financial side with growing it, with ghost hunting and paranormal, and they're not embracing it, and I think they really need to. And to be honest, what more, like, fun would it be if a bunch of us could go into the Cecile Hotel and conduct a giant investigation and maybe get some answers as to what is, you know, leading all of these people to want to jump out of the window? What's causing people to poison themselves? Why has there been a handful of veterans that have been attracted to this location? I'd be interested in taking, I have a couple of veterans that investigate with me that I could take in to try to contact, you know? But the Cecile Hotel isn't embracing it. They're not wanting people to have, they're not wanting to bring that kind of publicity to them. And it's a shame because the history, unfortunately, speaks for itself. You cannot take away history from a location like that. And I wish they would get some management or some ownership in there that could talk them into helping give them, you know, a boost that sounds like they may need. Another thing, though, is I think that they would have to boost up the security big time, at least on, you know, the main floor that you walk in. And, you know, I haven't even gone over with you guys the number of haunted experiences that people claim that they have there, even if they stay there for the night. But I will say, if you look up any of the reviews on it, a lot of people say that when they're staying there for the night, even to try to do an investigation, that they don't feel safe. They feel like, and it's not just the energy, we're not talking about the energy, we're talking about like the people that are, they're allowing to stay there because it's very inexpensive. They need to boost up the price on people staying there too. And it could also have the potential to do better, but I think that they're hurting financially, which is why they offer such a low price to stay there. And that's how they get in, you know, the people from Skid Row or different people in and out, because it's cheap. And usually if you have that kind of number on your business, that's kind of what you're going to get in. And you could get in potential murder, you know, people, or, you know, Jack the Rippers coming in to kill people. I don't know. It's just crazy. So, of course, the question I have for you guys is, what do you think happened to Elisa? You have seen the footage. What do you think has happened to her? I mean, it's heartbreaking to me, honestly, because it's so strange. There's nothing else like that. And we love paranormal, you know, all of us here at Ghost Girl Diaries and, you know, even you guys as my fans and followers. And it's such a strange thing to witness someone interacting with something that's following them and ends up, you know, pushing them to their death somehow. And it's completely unannounced. No one knows what happened. Nobody has a clue what happened. I think that American Horror Story had a great piece of land, property, and history to go off of. That is for sure. What do you guys think? Make sure you leave me comments below. Please give me a thumbs up on my video. Make sure you've subscribed to my channel if you haven't already. Follow me on social media, and I will catch you guys next time. Hell yeah. Back from the dead.